I've paid my dues time after time.
Well, that was pretty special. That was upstairs in what we used to call the Great Hall. I don't know if, what you call it these days. But I was on the entertainments committee. I wasn't the president. One of my best mates, Pete Dennis, was president. And I've just drunk a beer out of his mug because his tankard is engraved with his name. So we used to book all kinds of act. Like we used to book Spooky Tooth, Steamhammer, the bands of the day, Jethro Tull. We booked Jimi Hendrix up there. There were 1,000 people in there watching Jimi Hendrix. And I think it was only a couple of years later that suddenly we were actually playing in that hall, and it was packed. And I couldn't believe it, really. Suddenly we were sort of in the place that we dreamed of being. And I think, for me, as I remember, it was one of the first times when I realised that people actually knew our material and knew who we were. We weren't just trying to convert people. There was something going on out there. People knew what we were and they were excited. And we got our first review ever, I think, which was by Rosemary Horride in a magazine Disc. Called Disc. Yeah. Yeah. So, but it was an amazing night, just amazing. Sort of dreamlike, I think, in its intensity. What do you remember, Rod?
Well, we had so many experiences up in that hall, not all of them repeatable. And I do remember seeing great bands, Mighty Baby, Mott the Hoople, T-Rex, Tyrannosaurus Rex, as they were then, and all sorts of Procol Harum.
Deep Purple, yeah, Deep Floyd.
Deep Purple, yeah. So, you know, it's a great... That room up there was part of music history, really. Well, Thin, actually, without colleges, it really wouldn't have existed. You know, there's so much more available today with all the festival, the entire culture of festivals, which is a massive part of the English way of life now, it seems. But they were very few and far between then. And so it was the college circuit that was really the lifeblood of live music.
It was. It really was. Yeah. I think further to what Guy said, you know, in a sense, colleges kept live music alive in those days because there was nowhere else to play. It was very difficult. And I think it was hard to make a living, as perhaps it is now, I don't know, but it certainly was in those days because there just weren't the venues to play. And I remember seeing, you know, people like The Who in strange little sort of bars in Soho, you know, and it wasn't until you broke into the real, real big time that there was a career to be had.
It was tough because it was a catch-22 situation with, you know, you couldn't get a record deal unless you'd been seen live, and you couldn't get a gig unless you had a record deal, and so it was quite hard to break into that circle, wasn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I don't know if you ever know.
There's no such thing as overnight success or a particular point. It's just a sort of a gradual thing, really, even though it sometimes seems to other people like an overnight thing. So,
yeah, a gradual thing.
Top of the pops, probably.
As Roger said, it wasn't really a leap, it just happened very gradually, and I think we had what we thought were big ideas in those days. You know, we thought one day maybe we'll play the Rainbow, one day maybe we'll do this, but really everything that happened exceeded our dreams. We did play the Rainbow shortly after this, which was amazing. But I'd never heard of Madison Square Garden, I'd never heard of the Budokan in Tokyo, I'd never heard of Sao Paulo or Rio gigs or whatever, you know. And really everything that happened after about 1977 was way beyond any dreams that I'd ever had. I just didn't realise that world was out there. So it was an incredible journey for us. Always a bit more, always a bit better. And we were excited. We were always excited about, you know, what can we do next time? And we played Madison Square Garden for the first time. I flew my parents out there. And when we finished, we said, oh, maybe we can do it twice next time, you know. And we did. it's a kind of campaign thing. Oh, three. Roger would remember these things. So there was always the next goal. And it was a blast. It was an amazing journey. And still is, I have to say. Still is. How do you get the balance? Well, when you're young, you can just do everything all the time, can't you? That's the great thing. I can't anymore. Well, still try, probably. I still don't sleep. But, you know, we worked very hard at our studies and enjoyed it. You know, I was stimulated by physics and astronomy, I still am, and we worked really hard on our music as well, and we just, I suppose a change was always as good as a rest. I also taught for 4 years, I taught for a year because I'd done 4 years on my postgraduate, and that was just the point. I remember I was teaching in the day, we were rehearsing in the evenings, and I was trying to write up my PhD during the night, and then suddenly we just thought we should do this. You know, the opportunity came, and we thought if we don't go off and be this strange entity called Queen, which we just created, if we don't go off and do this now, we'll regret it for the rest of our lives, because this is a door opening, and doors do not open very often.
No, one shot. Yes.
Yeah. So if you want advice, that would be my advice. You know, work hard, look for the doors to open, but when the door opens, you have to walk through. And it's scary.
I think you, at that age, you're often full of a probably misplaced confidence, but you might even call it a certain arrogance that you probably learn isn't probably not, I don't know, correct. But I think you have a lot of faith in yourself, but you need that, you know. And so I don't think we were that nervous. We sort of believed in what we were doing, I think.
Yeah, sometimes I think you get more nervous as you get older because you've got sort of more to lose, in a sense. I've heard a lot of people say that. Yeah, we were young and we were full of ideas and we thought we were better than anyone else, sort of precociously. And, we just went out to conquer the world, in a sense. And it was foolish, in a sense. It was, like, ridiculous. But somehow it worked out, you know. I mean, we haven't really mentioned Freddie, you know. The beginnings of Roger and myself were with Tim Staffel. We were called Smile, and we did play in the room next to the bar, which was a sort of lounge bar, a few times, and we would jam, as I said. But by the time we came back to do this gig up here, we were Queen as such, and Freddie was with us, and so was John. And, of course, Freddie used to come and see Roger and I play in the early days and basically criticise. Say, yes, you're very good, but you should do this, and you should do this, you know, and you should be an act, and, you know, you should give everything you can. And Freddie was so full of ideas and dreams and plans in his head. He had great visions, both musically and visually. And it was an amazing coming together. The very first things we did were actually over in Meckenz. I had a sort of relationship with one of the old professors who did the bookings, and he allowed us, sort of at great cost, to go into one of the lecture theatres in Meckenz and rehearse. And we actually did a couple of little tiny gigs there. We invited people from the record business, hoping that they would discover us and give us a record deal. And of course, nobody ever did. And so we played, and we made our own popcorn and orange juice and sold it, you know, and there was probably 100 people at each gig. So they were the very first gigs we ever did with Freddie and with a bass player who actually with two or three bass players. I mean, we worked our way through bass players until we found John, luckily. Yeah. So there's a whole history went on with us.
It's that realisation, I think. You don't really realise that inherent value of a song, a successful song. Yeah, I think you're not in it for that at the time, and you also don't dream that your songs are going to last 40 odd 50 years, whatever. So that doesn't really occur to you, but it does occur to you with the passing of time. Yeah, but that wasn't really on our minds at the time. But I'm very glad that it does exist. That value. She's a cuckoo slip.